On today's episode, neon is suddenly in crisis, but we were warned. Today's episode is brought to you by engineering.com, a globally trusted source for engineering content. Check out this and many other exclusive videos for the engineering professional found only on engineering.com TV today. With all the COVID-19 and Ukraine war-induced supply chain breakdowns, very few people were surprised that computer chips are now in short supply. Now, for the automotive industry, the main explanation is that COVID-19 changed consumer preferences, and semiconductor manufacturers switched lines from automotive integrated circuits to those suited to smartphones and tablets. But very few, myself included, imagine that a global chip industry might be humbled by a shortage of neon. Neon? Now, it turns out that in those argon krypton lasers that are essential for the 14 nanometer chip architecture that's commonly used today, neon, 95% of the gas mixture inside the laser is neon, and it doesn't do the lasing, but it's still essential for the process. Now, it was described to me years ago by a professor this way. Now, imagine line dancing at Gillies, which dates me a little, and imagine three people on the dance floor, wide apart. You have no dance. Then imagine 300 people on the dance floor jammed together. Still no dance. Space the people apart correctly and the line dance works. Well, the neon does roughly the same function, keeping the lasing gas atoms just far enough apart to resonate between the mirrors in the tube. Now, that's a gross oversimplification, but you get the point. No neon, no laser. Now, other inert gases might work, but the systems are built around neon. So how does the industry make this stuff? Well, it's made by extraction from the air, which isn't easy because there's damn little of it in the atmosphere, about 18 parts per million by volume. Industrial processes make it by refrigeration of air until it becomes a liquid, then distillation of that liquid to boil off the individual fractions, a little like gasoline refining from crude oil. Now, the process is expensive, too expensive for you solely to get neon, but the steel industry uses this process to make massive quantities of oxygen gas, which is readily available from air. Trace gases like neon, xenon, and others boil off separately, and they're set aside for other industrial uses. But steelmaking is geographically scattered, with steel mills operating individually and producing relatively little of these scarce trace gases. To scale the process economically, you'd need to concentrate a large number of steel plants into a small area to create a large air distillation feed system. And the Soviet Union, always champions of mega projects, obliged by building massive concentrated steel complexes in eastern Ukraine. So all the ingredients of the crisis were in place. But the odd thing to me is, in 2014 and 2015, there was a brief conflict in eastern Ukraine, and semiconductor industry analysts at that time warned of the consequences of a serious supply interruption of neon. Now, in the intervening 8 years, it looks like no one did anything to diversify the neon supply chain, preferring to let one region of Ukraine supply half to three quarters of its critical process gas for the global chip industry. And it was also widely known that ramping up alternate supply couldn't happen at the flick of a switch. Large-scale distillation of liquid air to separate neon isn't like changing the air filter in your furnace. It requires major capital investment and time. Now, the Chinese are scrambling to ensure that their domestic industry has enough, and of course, neon prices are through the roof. Now, the people that make the lasers are looking for ways to reduce the amount of neon gas used in the systems, and it does wear out, and a major chip producer, TSMC, has started a recycling program. And new, very dense integrated circuits, like the new 7-nanometer and upcoming 2-nanometer ICs, well, they use a tin plasma process that may eliminate the need for neon altogether. But this is a stupid situation. A critical process gas used by an essential global industry whose primary supply has been known to be in a conflict zone for almost a decade, and no one did anything to diversify that supply. And it's not as if modern global manufacturers don't use very sophisticated hedging strategies to protect themselves against supply disruptions. I once visited an outstanding operation run by Jabil in the Bay Area, and they had a supply chain team that worked in something that looked like NASA's mission control, factoring every risk imaginable, including weather. But neon is the perfect storm. Too expensive to produce to justify large-scale standalone production facilities as a backup to cheap Ukrainian gas, but an absolute showstopper if chip makers can't get enough. This is a systemic manufacturing breakdown, and it's mirrored by the chip makers' customers as well. Automakers, dependent on a handful of global integrated circuit manufacturers, can't build enough cars to meet demand. And they were well aware of the consequences of excessive reliance on a fragile supply chain with few vendors. This short-term, quarter-by-quarter management, and no one knows how many industrial inputs are like neon, essential and controlled by a small and volatile vendor pool.
Now, de-risking these unknown but critical supply chains is essential. And by risk, I don't mean insurance coverage, but a real effort to diversify global supplies of critical inputs. Whether it's a tier one supplier jointly owned by the OEMs or centralized OEM agreements to purchase supply from alternate sources regardless of price to promote a broader supply base, if something isn't done, we can expect routine supply disruptions of components critical to a consumer economy. And that's a major factor in the runaway inflation the world is experiencing right now. The world is not a safe place for manufacturing. When a once-in-a-lifetime flood washes away your house, that doesn't mean that the next one won't happen for hundreds of years. It might happen next year. So the smart homeowner builds higher. High-tech manufacturers ought to think that way too. Well, that's it for today's episode of End of the Line, brought to you by Engineering.com. If you like this show, be sure to subscribe to our channel and click on the notification bell for our next episode. For our deeper engineering video series for the manufacturing professional, visit engineering.com TV to watch exclusive shows like Manufacturing the Future, not found here on our YouTube channel. The link is in the description below. Thanks for watching.